You are doing the 5 second or five.
Thank you.
All right, my name is Margaret Kosvar, and I'm here with Max Guttmann. The date is March 14, 1996. It's Richmond Heights, Ohio, the United States of America, and the interview will be conducted in English. Can you please tell us your name and spell your last name?
My full name is Max Marcus Ruben Guttmann, G-U-T-T-M-A-N-N.
And can you tell us where you were born and how you spell that?
I was born in the city of Katowice, at that time Germany, and that's spelled at the time K-A-T-T-O-W-I-T-Z. It is now Poland, and it is spelled K-A-T-O-W-I-C-E.
And your birthday, please?
My birthday is June 7, 1921.
And how old are you?
I will be 75 years old in a few months.
Can you tell us a little bit about the town in which you were born?
The town in which I was born is, first of all, the youngest of the Upper Silesian towns, the oldest being about 16 kilometers away, of 10 miles away, Beuthen, which goes back to the 13th century. Katowice became a city only in 1865. But it is an industrial center surrounded by coal mines, steel mills, zinc mills, ore mines, and so on. Highly industrialized, and as of today, extremely polluted and in bad shape. It began to grow really only when the railroad was brought through there. And by then, many of the managements from those coal mines and steel mills settled in the city, and it also became a railroad center. My family was connected with the city from the about 1880s or 1885, and my grandfather as a young man, my paternal grandfather as a young man, came to the city as an apprentice into a hardware store. He later on built his first, got his own store, and later on built, with the help of some others, the biggest steel bar business in Upper Silesia, a distribution center where he bought directly from the steel mills. He also was a member of the city council in the city from 1903 to 1920. And my father was born there, and my father later on worked there on and off. The happiest time probably for him between 1927 and 1933, when he was the business editor and deputy editor-in-chief of a local German language newspaper in Poland. He was a very versatile man who also wrote theater and music critiques was active in the B'nai B'rit as well in Beuthen as in Katowice and in other organizations. So I lived there on and off. When the city became Polish in 1922, 1 year after I was born, my grandfather wasn't there anymore. He did not speak Polish and he did not want to stay there. He had moved to Berlin. And subsequently, the company was sold to Polish partners, and my parents moved to Berlin in 1923, where my father got a job, which didn't last very long because the company went broke during the inflation. At that time, we moved back to Silesia, and this time to the city of Beuthen. That was a city where my mother was born, and my mother's family had been residing for many years. Beuthen is spelled B-E-U-T-H-E-N, and it had a suffix, O-S, which meant Oberschlesien in German, Upper Silesia, in contrast to another Beuthen, which was on the Oder River. The city is now known as Bytom, B-Y-T-O-M, That is really the original name at which it was incorporated in the 13th century. That whole area of Upper Silesia changed hands between Germans, Poles, Austrians, Bohemians, at one time even Duke of Luxembourg owned some of those properties there.
Before you go on, what was your father's name?
My father's name was Fritz. He had a doctorate in political sciences, political economics.
Okay, and what was your mother's name?
My mother's name was Gertrude. She was, her maiden name was Wachsner, W-A-C-H-S-N-E-R. She was born in 1900 in Boyton. And amazingly so, her father was a, for that time, very progressive man. He insisted that his daughter had an education, which was rare at the time. Most of those, especially among Jewish people also, thought that the woman belongs in the house and in the kitchen. Education wasn't important. My father, my grandfather said, if ever anything happens to a husband, if she gets one, when she was too young, said if she ever gets one, she will have to be able to support herself if something happens to her husband.
Did your mother ever have to support herself?
Oh, yes, very much so. She helped, first of all, to support the family when my father lost his job with the German language newspaper. And after the war, when my father passed away during the war, I think we'll get to that a little bit later, but after the war, when she came out of when the war began in the ghetto, she had support to support herself. And then when she came out of the camp, she had to support herself. And when she came to the United States, she had to support herself. Even so, after she got married a second time, her second husband in the beginning didn't earn a lot of money. And besides, she still wanted to be independent because he had his own child from his first marriage. My mother had two children from her first marriage. So she wanted to see if she can provide later on for their kids.
Prior to the beginning of the war, you said your mother helped out. What did your mother do?
Well, at one point she worked for a brief time in a book and paper stationery store to get a little bit more acquainted with the book trade. But eventually she opened a, which sounds funny in this country, private lending library. The ground stock for that came from my father's big library, which at one time was about 5,000 volumes. Then she bought more. At towards the end, in the beginning, when the war started in 1939, the library contained about 13,000 books in three languages. German, most of them, about 40-50% German, 45% Polish, and about 5% French. People were borrowing books and were paying either a fixed fee for a month to read as many books as they wanted, and that was, in the beginning, if I remember well, 2 zlotys a month. At that time, there were 6 zlotys to the dollar, about. And for the single book, you paid, depending on what it was, because bestsellers went for a little bit more and the other went for a little bit less. And so that was how mother helped before the war to support the family.
And did you help out?
Well, I had fun job to try to collect the books which people were reluctant to return. And on my bicycle, I traveled all over the surrounding suburbs and was not always friendly received by the people. There is never a good time to call on somebody and ask him, would you please return the book?
How old were you when you were doing that?
At that time, I was about 16, 17 years old. I was working already. I started probably to do that when I was 15, but then later on I was working already. I started to work when I was 16 and did this on the side, so to speak.
You had a sister.
I have a sister.
What's her name?
Who is 10 years younger. Her name is Vera, V-E-R-A. She went to a camp at the age of 12, survived, came early to America with the help of the Hayas, a joint, whatever. Got her education in America, has two bachelor degrees, a master degree in librarian sciences, and worked for over 20 years for the United States Army as a civilian employee, as a librarian. The last, since 1971, the last 20 years in Germany, before that 5 years in Korea, and about 2 years in New York at the Veterans Hospital.
How did you and your sister get along when you were kids?
Well, we got along pretty well as with a 10-year difference, age difference. At first, that was a little toy-like to have around. Later on, I loved her, she loved me. She especially when she got a little older and when I had a bicycle, she would wait when I come back from work and that I put her on my bike and drive around a little bit with her. The only time she was doing mischief to me was when I was collecting postage stamps and I had the stamps sorted out on the table and her nose would just about reach the level of the table and she would blow the stamps away, which did not make me very happy. But otherwise, we were getting along very well.
Yeah, it's not too bad.
No. How we didn't see each other very much. We parted when the war started, when she was 8. I saw her briefly when I came out of the army and I found her. She was 14. And then she went to Germany and subsequently to America. I didn't see her for another 13 years. And then she went to, she was here in America, in New York, and then she went to Korea and to Germany, so we never saw each other a lot since we grew up.
But you did have extended family prior to the war. You said you saw your grandparents, you knew your great-grandparents?
We had a great, big family, especially when we were living in Boynton, where my mother's family was. My father's family got kind of spread out a little bit over the world, mainly due to the fact that the border was drawn and Katowice became Poland. But my mother had her mother and numerous uncles, and my great-grandfather was there, and we would have Friday evening kiddush and dinner in my grandmother's house. My grandfather had passed away in 1923 when I was little, my maternal grandfather. And then we would go to my great-grandfather's house. And there were children, and grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, and the house was full. And there were some very strict rules. You never sat down on the place at the table where great-grandfather was sitting. That was a place reserved for him. But he loved us kids. He would take us to his little office because he had a business adjacent to his apartment and call us in and open his desk drawer and take out some chocolates for us, from very little ones to bigger ones. Everybody came in there. And of course, he would not smoke on Shabbos, but he had always a supply of big black cigars. And then the man would come in and he would pass out cigars to the man, which they were not allowed to smoke on Shabbos, of course, but they could take home with them. So there was a big family. There was a big family, there were cousins, second cousins, and so on. And from her mother's side, from the family, not too many survived. There are a few distant relatives. From my father's side, more, because some of them managed to get out, Australia, New Zealand. Israel.
Can you tell me where you went to school at?
I started school in that city of Boynton, which I mentioned once before, where the system was what is called in the United States separate but equal, which meant since Upper Silesia is predominantly Roman Catholic, all the Catholic kids went to the elementary schools closest to their homes. For two other confessions were separate municipal elementary schools. There was a Protestant municipal elementary school, and there was a Jewish municipal elementary school. The teachers were being paid by the city. The teachers were not all Jews. In my time, there was one Gentile teacher. There, the rest of them were Jews. There was no, were no classes on Saturday, in contrast to the other schools where in Germany at that time it was a six-day school week. From the second grade on, there were Hebrew classes in the afternoon, twice a week. And from the second grade on, some kids were selected to sing in the choir. There were two synagogues, the big one and the small one. And the big one was a kind of strange setup with a, on the one side, women and men sitting separately, the women on a second elevation, but there were, the choir consisted of boys and men, boys being the sopranos and altos, and no girls were allowed in my time. Later on, I found out, after I left, there were some girls. But there was an organ there, and there was a Gentile organ player. And so at for Americans, this is a rather strange combination, where on the one side, relatively conservative, but on the other side, a little bit kind of close to reform. But on the high holidays, my father, since he was busy working, attended temple mostly on the holidays. My maternal grandmother was every Shabbos, and she was very religious. As a matter of fact, I was afraid to go to her kitchen to not mess up the dishes between the meat and the dairy, because that was no-no. But when my father went to the temple, as it was done in Germany on the high holidays, he came in a top hat, dark coat, dark suit, and was very formal. Everybody came, elder men came in top hats and then changed in the temple to a yarmulke or whatever. But that was the custom there. And I sang in the, in the choir for 2 years. I would not say that I was the first soprano there. I think I never learned, I liked music, I never learned really to read music. So I was singing more by ear. But I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it tremendously. I especially enjoyed the organ, and I fell in love with organ music since then.
What kind of a kid were you?
Well, at times mischievous. My aunt and my mother's sister, at one point when she came to visit us here in 1970 or 71, said I was a good kid. I was at times mischievous. I know I I remember some of the things only from being told what I did. But while we were living in Berlin, I did hide at one time the key to the kindergarten when we were moved out. There was supposed to be some repair done at the building where we were, and they moved us into a Quinzenhut, and I didn't like that Quinzenhut. And I buried, allegedly, that key to the kindergarten in the garden somewhere. And when I was asked where it is, I said I sent it to my brother. I didn't have a brother. But they didn't know that.
And how old were you when you spoke? You
didn't know? 3 years old.
3 years old.
Yeah.
I'd say that was mischievous.
In Boyton, we lived on a cul-de-sac street in a residential area where there was little traffic. And so, as German boys did, we played soccer on the street. And it happened that we busted a few basement windows once in a while. It was nothing malicious. We were no vandals. But when you kick a ball, various things happened. I had always beat up knees because I was running around, and we had, I wrote in my memoirs, when we grew up, we were not afraid, and our parents were not afraid to let us run around. We went to the park. I went to the park when I was 8 years old, alone with my friends, and nobody worried that somebody is going to do any harm to us. His parents sent us to the store sometimes to do some buying if something was needed in the house that gave us a little piece of paper and some money and went to the store and said, we handed it in the store to the sales clerk and buy the stuff. I mean, it was a life. I had to walk, 20, 25 minutes to most of the city to go to the elementary school. And after my mother had taken me there once, I always walked alone. I mean, I walked with my friends, but we never were worried. Our parents were not worried. The city had at its peak about 100,000 population. And it was a quiet, quiet city. And so at life at that time, at the Weimarian, during the Weimarian Republic, before Hitler came, was wonderful. It became in that city very scary when a trial, which is famous in German history, before Hitler came to power, took place. I think it was in 1930 or 1931 when some Nazis broke into a house and shot a man in front of his mother because they suspected him of being a communist. The people got caught. There was, and it didn't take as long as in America, they don't wait 5 years for a trial. They took the guys to trial pretty fast.
The Nazis were taken in trial?
No, that was still before the Nazis came to power.
Okay, so who?
The Nazis, the court took the Nazis.
Okay, the Nazis were taken in trial.
Yeah,
okay.
To trial. The name of the prosecutor was Lachmann. I knew him because we had lived at one time in the same house. The process was called, known in history as the murder of Potempa. And when it came close to announcing the sentence, there was terror friction in the city. They had, which was rare in Germany, issued carbines to the police, militarized the police. There were policemen all over the place. It was forbidden to congregate in the city. For more than three people got together on a street corner, they were chased apart by the police. And I remember that day very well. Now, I have to explain, we lived on Main Street in a big house, which was owned by my grandmother. In the back of that house where it was the printing plant from a new local newspaper. And in the entrance to the house, which was like a covered driveway, there were glass vitrines where the paper always was hung out, the newspaper. So people were standing there all the time. I had at that time private art classes with a teacher who would take a couple of kids and do something. My mother always wanted us kids to do something, be involved in something, so I had art classes. There was an art class when my mother suddenly came and said, let's go. Go home. And we did not go the usual way. But she took me into a house on a street which runs parallel to the street on which we were living. And we went through the house into the backyard. There was a door in a fence. She went to the door, and suddenly we were in the backyard of my grandmother's house. Now, that was a big house my grandmother had, and it had two yards. There was one front yard surrounded by buildings, and then there was another backyard where on the one side my grandparents had a little piece of garden, and on the other side there was some little factory. I never knew that there existed a gate there. That my mother knew that because she had grown up in that house. So they wouldn't take me to the house from the front. There was a big iron gate over there which had been closed. It turned out by then the papers, the glass in the vitrines had been smashed up already because they had printed a special edition of the paper and shown that the man had been convicted. They had been found guilty and been convicted. And immediately a riot broke out from the Nazis. So we went up in an apartment And in the streets, it was wild. My father came in by train. We lived about 5 minutes from the railroad stations. My father came in by train from work. And he had a key, and he opened the door and got in the house. And some friends of the family came. And in the evening, as soon as it got dark, the Nazis were milling in the street, and they were walking forward and back, and they had smashed up a couple windows in Jewish stores. And the friends of, now something strange happened. The friends of my parents were looking out, and one of the ladies had, I don't know if you know what a lorignon is. Hold it in one hand.
And the lorignon, what is it?
It's like eyeglasses, but you hold it on a stick, mm-hmm. and you can put together, and when you flip a switch, it opens up, and you have two glasses. And that fell out. We lived what is considered in America the third floor. It fell down on the street. My father went down, opened the door, and there was a policeman standing and said, you were lucky, it didn't hit anybody, and it didn't break, and gave it to my father. But it turned out that that policeman was a Jew. Now, that was an absolute rarity in Boynton, a Jewish policeman. We got to know that man a little bit closer afterwards. He became a friend of the family. He was a Zionist. He wanted to go to Palestine. And he knew they needed in Palestine people eventually who knew how to handle guns. And in Germany, you can buy a gun. And in Germany, it was hard to learn other way to handle guns other than to enlist in the army. But the German army was restricted by the contract of Versailles to 100,000 men, and you had to enlist for 12 years. 10 years. Well, that was a little bit too long for Ralph. His name was Ralph Rosenzweig. So he enlisted in the police. That was the next good thing to do. And he was learned how to handle guns and so on. He was a good policeman. He came on Yom Kippur, which is a temple, because they were assigning some policemen to guard there. So he went with a Gentile policeman. And at one point, he was getting some correspondence, which he didn't want to come into. The police over there, by the way, was living in barracks. And he had some mail, which he didn't want to come to the barracks. So one day, that some of the mail came to my our house. It was before Easter. And my mother wanted to have it sent to him as quick as possible. So she went.
Okay, so the mail came to your house.
The mail came to my house. My mother went and bought an Easter egg from paper, which you could put together, put some candy in there, put the letter on the bottom, put the candy on top, gave me the Easter egg, said, get on the bus, ride out to the barracks, and say, see that you deliver it to what they called Wachmeister Rosenzweig. Well, I got there, and there was a guard in front of the barracks, and a little kid comes in and says, I was 10 years old about at the time. I have an Easter egg for Wachmeister Rosenzweig. He said, go ahead. He pointed which building it was, and I brought him the Easter egg, and that was my first involvement in conspiracy against Hitler.
He did get to Palestine.
He subsequently quit the police in Boyden, and he got to Palestine. And I know my aunt who had met him, my aunt who lives in Israel, as a matter of fact, I saw from some letters I found lately that she had heard of him, that he had gotten to Israel and was in the police. He was in the British police school where he was being trained together with Arabs to be in the British police in Palestine.
There comes a point when your family has to leave Boynton.
1933 in spring, and again, this is to me anecdotal, some of the details, because at the time, 11 years old, 12, shortly before my 12th birthday, I didn't understand all the goings on. My father was called to the Gestapo. Apparently, they had not liked some of the things he had written in the paper. And they told my father that he has to get out of Boynton. Now, I had to explain that when my father joined the paper, which was in Poland, we were, by the fact that Katowice had become Polish in 1922, Polish citizens. A fact of which I, in 1932, at first was not aware either. When the paper hired my father, they made it as a condition that he kept the Polish citizenship, even so until 1928 he had been entitled to apply to receive the German citizenship. But the paper, which was owed by Germans, didn't want that because they were afraid the Poles could kick him out if he is a German citizen and would not allow to give him a working permit. So now we are Polish citizens. My father is called to the Gestapo and they tell him, get out from here. My father immediately packed some stuff because he was afraid they might going to arrest him. But before that happened, my still parents were called to the school and were told that I would be allowed to finish the school year, which in Germany at that time ended in April, and that the next year I would not be allowed to enroll anymore. And even so, that the principal of the school was a personal friend of my parents. He gave them to understand that that was not his doing. He could not say so outright. Apparently, he was afraid already that somebody might be listening in or whatever, but that was the situation as it was. And so my father immediately rented a room with a family, furnished room, and stayed in Poland. And the whole family went on a vacation into Poland temporarily for the summer because we couldn't get an apartment. Katowice was a shortage. But the biggest problem was I didn't speak a word of Polish at the time. Then I had to go to school in Poland. I couldn't go to a Polish school because, first of all, my father still worked for a German newspaper. But besides, I also didn't speak Polish. So I enrolled into a private German high school where Polish was one of the obligatory subjects. But where after I had passed an entrance examination in all the other subjects, I had been exempted from a Polish examination under the condition that within the first school year I would make up and be able to, from the second year on in that school, to follow the Polish classes as everybody else did, which I did. So I spent the summer, first of all, in a place near Bielitz, Bielsko. Bielitz, it was in Germany, that was former Austria until the end of World War I. It's spelled B-I-E-L-I-T-Z in Polish, Bielsko, B-I-E-L-S-K-O. We went in a suburb there which was called Gypsy Forest. I spent most of the days, my teacher was high school student in his last year, just before he went to the university, and he murdered me with Polish classes from morning till late afternoon. I had barely time to go a little bit on the swimming pool. And then in fall, I entered the school there, and in January of 1934, by January 1934, we had an apartment found in Katowice, and the whole family moved to Katowice.
So everybody was living in Katowice then?
Everybody was in Katowice.
When did you and your father separate from your mother and sister?
My father, we separated from mother and sister on about 2 weeks, 2 weeks, 3 weeks before the outbreak of the Second War.
So in 1939?
The war broke out. The war broke out in the morning hours of September 1st, 1939.
Okay, before we get...
We live 16 kilometers, which is about 10 miles from the border.
Okay, before we get to that, you separated from your mother and sister 2 weeks prior to that.
Yeah.
Okay. Why did you separate from your mother and sister?
Since, as I pointed out, Katowice was about 10 miles, give and take a few, from the border. And the Poles had a big mouth at the time, said, we are going to be in 1 week, we're going to be in Berlin. He said, well, it would be safer if my mother, who was not quite well, she just had been after a bout with ischias, my mother and my sister would be a little bit farther away from the border. And there were school vacations still in August, so he sent them into central Poland, into a town called Konskie, K-O-N-S-K-I-E, where he had some business associates who had promised they would look after mother a little bit. And so they went 2 weeks before, two or 3 weeks before the war started. I stayed with my father back. My father's boss was in England, so my father was running the company for which he worked at the time, which was a scrap and metal dealer. And I was an intern in a brick and ceramics factory. So when the war broke out, my father went to work, and I went to work at noon on September 1st. At about 3 o'clock, we had a shell, a German artillery shell, fall on the factory, which wounded some military people who had been using our smithy to shoe their horses. And by then, my boss, who was a Jewish fraternity brother of my father's, which is a point which is important in one way also, said, well, that's it, and we tried to extinguish the kilns. And by then, my father came and said, let's go. We can stay here. We tried to join my mother.
How old were you when the war started?
I was 18.
Obviously, you knew about Adolf Hitler.
Pardon?
Obviously, you knew about Adolf Hitler.
Yeah. I had seen the Hitler Youth march in Beuthen as a kid, and when I looked out, I told you, we lived on a main street, and I saw the troops the marching with kennel, no, not kennel, what do you call them, flares at night, and with drum and pipe and drum corps through the cities with their flags. I had been at one point accosted by, when I came back from a choir practice, and I had my prayer book, my siddur under my arm, I was accosted by two kids who beat me up and threw my prayer book that it fell down, and it fell down so that it was open and two pages got dirty. And every time since, when we came in a temple to that point, I was very embarrassed about that part. We knew that I had known anti-Semitism as a kid, found out about it. I had seen the Nazis come to power. I was in 1930 on the Baltic Sea, and I saw them getting on the beaches around with their Hakenkreuz, with their swastikas, and so. I was aware. Nobody was aware how this is going to develop.
Well, what were you thinking when the war started on September 1st, 1939?
Let's get out of here. That was one thing I thought, because that was the first time I heard really shooting, and I was at the airplanes flying around. I didn't, on the first day, except for that artillery shell, I did not see any ordnance landing anywhere. But I heard it going all day long, from the morning when I got up, and I was frightened when I saw the people running away. there was a stream of people with hand wagons, hand-carried wagons, and with horses, and without anything, carrying stuff on their back, and just going and going. Some probably had an idea where they were going. Maybe they had relatives a little bit farther away, but nobody knew that in the city of Katowice, where I was born, the Germans would be 3 or 4 days after the war had started. At that point, if you didn't run fast, it didn't matter. I mean, we were lucky at that point when we got out as far as we did get out. But people were trying to run away with cars, and they would run out of gasoline and would leave their cars standing on the street, on roads, on highways, because there was nowhere to go anymore. People would leave their belongings in their cars. I know of friends of the family who were the father was a dentist and one of the daughters was a dentist. The father was abroad and at that time in France and ended in Portugal and subsequently in Montreal, Quebec. But the other daughter was with her mother fleeing and they left some of the gold in the car, which they had to abandon. Dentists always used to have gold, and they took some gold with them, and they left some of the gold in the car. How do I find out? Because their son came one evening to us where we were, and they had some gold left, and he asked my father, who was working for some shoe factory, if he knew a cobbler who would put gold in the shoes, so that when they get out from there, they could take it with them.
So the war begins, and you and your father decide that you're going to go try to get to your mother. Do you leave immediately on September 1st?
We leave September 1st. We lived in a suburb called Piotrowice, and which was about 3 stops on the commuter train into the city. And we had passes, so there we didn't need a ticket. We had a monthly pass. We came into Katowice in the main railroad station, and there is a sign posted over each of the windows that if you want a ticket for more than 20 kilometers, you have to have a permit from the county administrator. And that was nonsense. So we bought a ticket. We looked at there was a board which was lighted where always the trains would light up which were going out. And there was a train, it lighted, the light went on. It said there's a train to going to Mislovice and Oświęcim. So we went and we bought a ticket to Oświęcim. Well, needless to say, we didn't know. By then, Oświęcim was a town with about probably 50% Jewish population. I don't know, I didn't count them, but approximately.
That town is better known as something else. What
but
is it better known as?
Yeah, the town is, that town is better known as Auschwitz, but interestingly enough, it was contrary to what people think. It was Auschwitz long before it became Oświęcim. I just had some research on it. It was Auschwitz already in the 12th century.
Okay.
And we got to Auschwitz. And there was another train there, and we said, where is it going? Because you just took wherever a train was going away east, away from the Germans.
I don't mean to interrupt you, but did you and your father go home and pack anything?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so
we packed something. We packed something and we packed the wrong things. We packed absolutely. I took my stamp collection and I took some books with formulas for ceramic glazes and which I had worked out in the lab and stuff. And we took some clothes, but we didn't take any of the winter clothes, because it was September, and anybody who lived at the time, September 1939, to the detriment of the Poles, had beautiful weather. If it would have rained, the Germans might have gotten stuck in the mud somewhere because Polish roads were not very good. But it was brilliant weather. It was warm. So we had the wrong stuff.
I didn't mean to interrupt you. I'm sorry. So you decided to take another train at that point?
Well, we took another train. And the train went to, they said the train is going to go to Krakow. Now, What we had with us was a map of Polish railroad lines. So we didn't have a schedule because a schedule was meaningless anyhow, but that had been part of a schedule, and we took that with us so that we could follow and perhaps make some plans. The plans were good for nothing. We didn't even go to the main station in Krakow. We went to one of the, around the city, and we stopped shortly on the station on a place which is famous in Schindler's List, Płaszów. We have two places already. We have Auschwitz, and we have Płaszów. It's not the rest, it's not all. We come to others which have become notorious. And the train, but by that time we still are on passenger trains, and we had only one ticket to Auschwitz, and since then we hadn't bought any ticket, and nobody bothered to ask us. We were hungry, we hadn't any food with us. So the train wasn't really going very fast. We sometimes were standing for 2 hours under a semaphore, under a signal, and then some farmers would come and sell something to eat. In one place we got some rutabagos, I think, from the field, and we're eating raw rutabagos or so. Didn't matter, whatever it was. Then we came to a place called Dębica. D-E with a little tail, B-I-C-A. There we got off the train, because not far from there was a Jewish farm in which I had spent vacation once. And I said that would be a good place to be because probably the farm didn't bomb and it would be nice to go there. But first we went into the city, and as we walked out of the station there were two big craters, huge, from bombs. The one had been a hotel once. There was nothing left. And we went in the city, and I see like today there is a dairy store, and there's a sign in the window. Wilbeck suit, and inside there is such a massive block of butter with a knife in it, and there's nobody there, but the door is closed. So my father went, and in the center, my father got a shave there at the barber shop. And there was a sausage factory which had a little store open, and they were selling sausage by the yard. There was a big basket in Polish kielbasy or sausage. There was a guy who was selling it. And we bought, I don't know, a yard or 2 yards of the sausage, and we bought some bread because we had been hungry terribly. And a bakery. We had a whole loaf of bread and had some sausage and back to the railroad stations. It turned out there was no train going to that place where the farm was. So we hopped on the next train which came by, which was a freight train. And we went somewhere. And really, instead of getting closer to my mother, we were getting farther away. But then we came to a station where there was again a railroad junction, and there was a train going in that direction where mother was supposed to be. This time it was nice passenger cars, so comfortable. And there was one guy who was running. We also were moving and standing, moving, and every time a plane was showing up, a German plane was showing, this train stopped, and everybody hopped out into the ditches. There was a guy there with some medal on his civilian suit, and he said, I had to be 2 hours ago at the general staff in Warsaw, and he never got there. Well, we stopped in one city for about 2 days, probably, day and a half. My father went to the market there, which was in a way important, because Rudnik on the River San, because later on a physician from there was our caretaker in a way. And then the train went for a few miles farther, and then the machinist said, I live in that village, and the next bridge about a few miles away has been destroyed, so the train isn't going any farther, so you do what you want, I'm going home.
He just left the train sitting there in the middle of the track.
He extinguished the fire, and because of steam locomotives, extinguished the fire in the locomotive, let the steam out, and went home. And we went in the fields and were hiding from the German planes who were flying over there. I came in to a little town called Stalowa Wola, which means steal will. Will from not well, but from to want something, which was industrial center the Poles built to have some industry farther away from the border. And there some people offered us to buy some horses to go away, but we declined. And then some other people offered us to take us in a car with them. It was employees from an oil company who were going to the headquarters. There were already three people in the car and was full of luggage. And we paid a princely sum to be taken to the city of Lublin. And never got there. That's when I really saw for the first time war damages. We came through a little town, Janov Lubelski, J-A-N-O with a dash, W, and then dash, Lubelski, L-U-B-E-L-S-K-I, and there a lumberyard was burning. There was had been a straight hit in a lumberyard. There were not dead horses on the street, all over the place, and the place looked just terrible. And we drove through a sand desert, came to a town where we were able, Modli Mojice, where we were able to buy some bread, and slept overnight in the car. Because as we were on the way to Lublin, we were told they don't let any people into Lublin. Lublin is being bombed by the Germans. It doesn't make any sense to go there. So we drove us to a town called Bilgoraj, B-I-L-G-O-R-A-J, notorious. All the Jews from there were killed later. It was a predominantly Jewish town. Somebody took us in for a few hours to wash up a little bit. And then we took a nightmarish train ride on a narrow gauge railroad on platform cars, which were shaking like the devil. And there was nothing to hold on to. And we ended up in another notorious later place called Belzec. That's where we met the main railroad. There, as we crossed the street, a car passed by and stopped, and a guy came out and was calling my father's name. It was a Jew who was an officer in the Polish intelligence. He had been in the Polish intelligence in the war against the Soviets. And those veterans had gotten later on, regardless if they were Jews or not, some privileges. And he had gotten a license to buy scrap iron from military sources and from government places and sell them. So that's how my father knew him, from the scrap iron business. But when the war started, he had been drafted again. He was again with intelligence. And he said to my father, Dr. Guttmann, I don't go anywhere. Stay in the railroad station. I will be back in half an hour, and I take you with me in my car.
Do you remember his name?
Yeah. I don't know what his real name was, but his name was Polonski.
Okay. Thank you. Go ahead.
And we sat down in the station, and about half an hour, the station master comes out and says, is a Dr. Guttmann here? Yeah. Well, we just had a telephone call from the gentleman who talked to you on the road. His orders have changed. He is not coming back. So we hopped on the next train which came, which was so full. There were those European-style express train cars with a corridor and compartments inside. Well, we got pressed into the toilet at the end of the corridor and rode with the window open, three or four people standing in that toilet, until we came to the city of Lemberg in Austria, the was called in Polish, it is Lwów, L-W-O-W, and now the Ukrainians called it Lviv, L-W-I-W. We stopped at the outskirts of the city, and the first thing we saw, there was a flour mill, Axelrota, I think was called, in flames, was burning. Went into the city, and there were constantly air alarms, in the house, and hiding. My father went to visit a rabbi, who at one time had been a rabbi in our city. He was very noncommittal and would not say much to my father, and neither help nor nothing. And so we went, first of all, being hungry, found a Jewish restaurant and had something to eat there. And then we found out that from another station at night there would be a train going to towards the Romanian border. So we walked, we took a streetcar into that direction in the evening, and then we walked the rest to the station. And at that point we met four or five other men who we knew. Two or three were from our city. One was the father of the uncle, or the brother-in-law, I'm sorry, the brother-in-law, Mr. Thaler, a brother-in-law of a former school friend of mine. But she had lived with him because her mother and her father had died early, so she lived with her older sister, with this brother-in-law. And it turned out, I found out later, the other one was the fellow who was by then already, unbeknownst to me, the husband of that girl who had been in my class. She had gotten married early. And one was a textile manufacturer from Bielsko, a city I had mentioned before. So now we were seven, us together.
All right, so there were seven of you, you said.
Yeah, and now we're boarding another train, and we are going in the direction of the Romanian border. And we are getting to another rather known Jewish town in Poland, first Stanisławów. Today it is called Ivano-Frankivsk by the Ukrainians. But then we got into where we had... Food is always, when you run away, an important thing. And so in Stanislav, there were no bombs yet. In Lwów, they were constantly bombing us. In Stanislav, when we arrived, there were no bombs yet. And so we had breakfast, and by the time we finished breakfast, the bombers were coming. And so we got on another train, and we went to a town called Kolomyja, K-O-L-O-M-Y-J-A. Now from there, it's about walking distance to the Romanian border. Then we met one of the Katowice rabbis, whom my parents knew. His name was Fogelman. He later on was a military rabbi at one point in Israel. At one time he was a rabbi in the suburb of Haifa, in Kiryat Chaim or Kiryat Motzki. Anyhow, he survived. And he was living there with his in-laws, and so they were all together, and they were making a nasife, what is called in the leaders at a meeting, and we're trying to decide what to do. And some went, let's go to Romania, and let's not go to Romania. And so no decision really was made. But a very nice couple, a lawyer named Kramer, took us in for the night. It was on Friday evening, so the rabbinim were busy getting ready for Shabbos, so there wasn't much time to talk to us. That was the first time. That was 1 week after we had started off, because the war started on Friday. September 1st was a Friday, and that was next Friday. And we finally could take a bath. We slept in a bed. That was like heaven for a moment. And in Colombia, they were not bombing. But the next day, there was no use to stay there. And my father had doubts. My father at that, in 1939, was 47 years old. By Polish law, he was still obligated to military service. So he was afraid if we go out of Poland. And at that time, there were rumors that Neil Wolf, the German advance, had been stopped by the Poles. That if we get out and the war comes to an end, he can be considered a deserter. And you know, this is what I call, excuse me for the expression, the bloody Prussian upbringing. That respect for authority and that fear of doing something which is not quite legal. It is oftentimes in life a hindrance, as much as it helps in some ways, but it is often a hindrance. So we were on a train, and we were passed on the train through another famous place, in who knows literature and seen the movie with Danny Kaye, The Colonel and I, Horodenko, because that man, that Jew in that movie that Danny Kaye represents, allegedly is from Horodenko. And we pass to Horodenko, and then the train goes into Romania. Romanian soldiers are standing on the running boards because nobody can go in and out. You don't need a passport. The train runs for about 3 kilometers or 3 or 4 miles to Romania. There's no customs or nothing. And then on the other side, they jump off the running boards and you're back in Poland. And you come to a station called Zaleszczyki, and this is where it was a spa. And that's where you can cross into Romania. But my father decided no. And the other five, because decided no also. And so we stay on the train and we continue to travel. And now for the first time, a conductor comes in and he demands to sell us tickets. We have been traveling since Oświęcim without a ticket. And here a nut is suddenly, he wants tickets. He pocketed the money for himself. There was nobody there anymore to collect it from him. And so we got into a town called Tarnopol, T-A-R-N-O-P-O-L. I knew I had acquaintances there. I had spent the summer of 1936 on a Jewish farm, as I had mentioned, that we wanted to go there. I had fallen in love with the daughter of the administrator, had corresponded with her, and two of her brethren were working in Tarnopol. One was a beer brewer, mm-hmm. brewmaster, and the other was an assistant. We said, we're going to go and see them. We went to see them, and they said, we are packing our things. We are going to Russia. We're not waiting for the Germans. I think the younger one of them had a little bit of communist interest before already. But in order to get out from there, we also needed a permit from the county. This time we went. We went to the county, and we got onto a train in the evening and came to a town called Zbarash. By then we had heard rumors that from the city Koinskia, where my mother was, they had evacuated people into the direction of the Lithuanian border of Vilna. So now we're not trying anymore to go there, we're trying to go in direction of Vilna. And our schedule, our map, shows us that from Zbaraj there is no train. But there is a town, again known in Polish history, Krzemieniec, from where there is a train connection in the direction of Vilna. So the seven of us hire two farmers, unbeknownst to us, Ukrainians. And they agree for a lot of money to take us to Zbaraj. That was one nightmarish light at night in the dark with people whom we didn't know, where we didn't know that there were Ukrainian bands in the forest over there, and where the roads were not roads. This is a piece of dirt. And when it rains, you probably can't drive through. That's something like people were going in the Wild West in America years ago. At one point at night, the horses stopped. There must have been some bridge or something, a little stream. Any case, we got into Krzemieniec in the wee morning hours, and here suddenly they dropped us at the edge of the town and went back. Luckily, they neither robbed nor killed us. And then there is a stream of vehicles, civilian and military, going through, which later out we found out was the Polish government running, and the general staff running away to Romania.
Can I ask you this question? I know eventually you fall into the Russian hands. Mm-hmm. Where is it that you run into the Russians?
In Krzemieniec. Well, first of all, in Krzemieniec we went to sleep in the evening. And before we went to sleep, a military motorcycle had stopped and called my father's name, the guy who was riding it. And he said he was the son of one of my grandfather and my father's former partners. He was a reserve officer. And he said, "Dr. Guttmann, the Russians are coming." And my father said, "Are they going with us or against us?" He said, "That we don't know yet." So we went to sleep, and in the morning we heard that the Russians had come, but we didn't see any. Well, that was a dead place, and that lieutenant had told us, get out from here and see that you get into a big town, because in the small places it's going to be terrible. So we first went back to Zbaraj. We hired another farmer, this time only one. We all squeezed into one wagon. Money was running short. Went back to Wanovce on the border, not Zbaraj, Wanovce. Went back to Wanovce, stayed in Wanovce 8 days until the first train wasn't there. One day, a group of Russians came on a truck. It was the first Russians we saw. It turned out they were from the fire department. The reason being that the fire department in Russia is part of the Ministry of the Interior. Now, the Ministry of the Interior doesn't take there are forests, but this is the Ministry of the Police, and the fire department was subordinated to the police, because when there is a fire, there is suspicion that it is sabotage. So that were the first Russians we saw. When a train came, finally, it consisted of one freight car, a wood-fired locomotive, two engineers on the locomotive, and an officer from the tank trucks. Some tank groups could see by his insignia as the escort. And that was the first military Soviet whom we saw. And then we went back into Tarnopol, and were first housed by some Jews who had, there were immediately lots of organizations who were trying to help. Couple nights we slept in an abandoned apartment on straw, but then we found some people, and some people were sending us to other people, and we were housed here and there. And suddenly we met more people from our city, and I went back to the brewery and found out that my girlfriend had arrived there with her parents. They had been running away from the farm too, but they had horses. So they went with their horses, with their wagon. And I got a job in the brewery, schlepping sacks with barley and malt. My father subsequently got a job with the shoemakers as an accountant. And then we rented a room. But in the meantime, one more thing happened. One day, a lot of men from Katowice arrived. They explained to us that they had gotten a summons from the Nazis to appear on a certain day at the sports palace in the city and had been given a list what to bring with them. Underwear, how many pair of underwear, socks, so on, so on. An axe, if they have one, a spade, tools, anything, because they are going to be sent to work somewhere. What they did, they drove them to a railway station called Nisko. That's not far from where our train abandoned us. And they were told, get out, and they were pointed in that direction, said, this is where the Russian border is. Because in the meantime, the Russians had occupied part of Poland. They had come to the Bug River. Said, you go over there. You got 24 hours to disappear. And at the station, some farmers were waiting with wagons and offered the people to carry the luggage. And some were dumb enough to give them the luggage, and the farmers had disappeared with their luggage. Barely it was on the wagons.
Okay, let me ask you this. You were not with these men, though?
No.
Okay, this has been relayed to you?
We met them, and they came, and some of them were friends of my father's.
Okay, so they eventually show up here.
They told us about how that whole procedure went.
Okay. If we can get back to the story that you saw, that you witnessed. At some point, you fall into, the Russians offer you an ultimatum, correct?
And
we need to get to that part of the story.
Yeah, in spring of 1940.
Okay.
Yeah. Spring of 1940. It could have been still winter. It was a terrible winter. Cold. All the refugees, by then they had taken care of various other people, sent them to Siberia. Now they were taking on the refugees. They were in the city about a nice few thousand. They were called to appear at certain days to the NKVD, police, militia, NKVD, all in the same building. And they only work in the evening. And we are being interviewed by a colonel who gives us, after filling out some papers with all the questions, personal data, said, what is your decision? You've got two choices. You can accept Soviet citizenship or you can go back to Poland. My father had made since he had a good job, I then had made an application to the Soviets, and we had found out where my mother is, and my sisters, and they had to return. In the meantime, they were in Sosnovitz. My father had filed an application with a certificate that he had a job to permit my mother and my sister to join us in Tarnopol. So he told the colonel, what about my wife? Can she, my sister, my daughter, can they join me here? And at that point, the colonel said, and that I am a witness to what he said. I mean, I may not need the words exactly, but the gist of it is, what do you need your wife for? Get yourself another one. Well, at that point, my father said, we are going back to Poland. Now, there were rumors that there is going to be a committee which will review those repatriation requests and so on. And in Lemberg, they allegedly had seen already Germans. So it was done because my father said to me, the most important thing is the family together. It never came to it. On June 27, 1940, after midnight, two men in what I call civilian uniforms, which means they were not really uniforms, they were high boots, black riding breeches, and black, those Russian rubashkas, knocked at the door, came in, he said, Guttmann Fritz Bernardovich and Guttmann Max Fritzovich. Yeah, he had our papers, all the forms. Pack your things, you are going back to Poland. But pack everything, don't leave anything. Well, to make a long story short, there was a truck waiting. Our landlords were able to give us a little bit food on the way. There was a truck standing in front of the building. They drove us to the railroad station. They loaded us on, subsequently in due time, on freight cars, 40 people to a freight car. And for 2 days we were standing on that station. For the first 12 or more hours, we didn't even get a bucket of water to drink. There was one baby in our compartment which was still nourished by its mother. They allowed some people from the city, from my father's company, they came and with a payroll, and my father got some money, and some other people got some money. They allowed that. But otherwise, from that one side of the train, they were checking who was, and they were allowing a few people. The other side of the train, soldiers with carabines and bayonets on their carabines were patrolling, going forward and back, which did not hinder certain people from the city to come in. And when the soldier was going this way, they snuck to somebody here, and when he come the other way, they knew they wouldn't shoot. I mean, that cruel, they hadn't been yet at that time, at least. And so a girlfriend I had met over there came to me 3 times. She brought me food, she brought me something to drink because we were thirsty, it was hot. She climbed over fences, she got in between freight trains, under the trains and so on, and other people also were getting stuff there. But the next night, rain and night, suddenly the doors opened and 2 officers came and he said, Chowastaki, that means bachelors or bachelorettes, out. They considered a bachelor at the time anybody who was not with a family, a wife, so. My father said, we're not bachelors, we are family together. And so did a couple of our other friends who were brothers or so. From our car, nobody left. But some people did. And until 1943, November 1943, I didn't know what happened to them. Because some of the people were our friends who left there. They were taken away. And then about 36 hours after we had been embarked on the train moved. And the moment the train moved, we knew we were not going to Poland. We knew we were going to Russia. Because one of the directions, but besides, we stopped at a station which again in German literature is known, Podwoloczyska. There was a writer, Roda, who wrote a story about that. And I knew that story. So we were at Podwoloczyska and we went into Russia. We were on the train about probably 10 days, 12 days, I don't know exactly. We went to Kiev. We were in Rostov on the Don. We were in Penza. We were in Kazan, Sverdlovsk.
Okay, and where did you eventually end?
We ended on the railroad line, on a sideline of the rail line which goes from Yekaterinburg to Vladivostok, past the line separating Europe from Asia in Siberia. And the district, or as the Russian call it, oblast of Tumen, which is T-Y-U-M-A-N, County Tugulin, sector 248 of the Bakhmetsky forest industry. That was one at the beginning. One around 1 huge log cabin divided in several parts on one side of the railroad tracks, a more modern barracks building on the other side of the railroad tracks, and a couple single houses about 2 or 3 miles away, all together about 1,000 people in that settlement.
So you arrive in Siberia. When do you arrive in Siberia?
First days of July, 10th, 15th, about between 10th and 15th of July, 1940.
Okay. You arrive in Siberia, and what do you do?
The same evening, we were assigned places, and all those unattached men got one big room. There were about 25 of us, and we got assigned. They had made, there were no beds in the beginning. There were two rows of, like, bunks, and you got assigned a mace on your bunk, and then we were called outside, and there was a commandant. Introduced himself as his name being Commandant Fifilaktov in a field uniform. And he told us, now you are here as special resettlers, Spetsperishelinci in Russian they call it. And you are going to live here, and he said, when hair is growing on my hand, that's when you're going to go back to Poland. You're going to live here, you're going to die here. In the meantime, the mosquitoes were biting like hell. He said, ничего. Ничего, it means never mind. You'll get used to it. He said, you're going to work in the forest. Tomorrow morning, you're going to get your tools, and we're going to assign you to your jobs. In the morning, came a man who introduced himself as a foreman, Mr. He told us still, that commandant, you have no political rights, which means you must address all the Russians here, all the Soviet citizens, as гражданин, as citizen, so-and-so, a citizen so-and-so. You're not allowed to call him comrade. You are not allowed to elect your spokesman. I'm going to assign a spokesman for every one of the halls in which you live. You have no right to elect anybody or anything. Your mail is going to be delivered through our control. But you have full economical rights, which means you have to get paid the same as Soviet citizens are getting paid for their jobs, with the provision that 10% of your earnings are going to be deducted to keep for the NKVD, for apparently he didn't explain us, for supervising us, for taking care of us. The next morning, the foreman came, Mr. Grazdanin, citizen Vilimovsky, and some of us got assigned to sawmill, and some I got assigned to the forest. My father and I, we got two axes and a saw and a bottle of kerosene and a rag and on a stick, and we were led to the forest, and we were shown how to cut down trees, and the bottle of kerosene was needed because in summertime the raisin sticks to the saw, so you moisten the saw a little bit with raisin, and we were told what to do and how many cubic meters of what we had to produce every day.
How long did you work for the Russians like that?
Well, first of all, we were so good in lumberjacking that from that job we got transferred, because we would have gone through the forest in no time. And we got assigned to sawmill, which was a little better. And then I got assigned to various jobs, and subsequently my father to other jobs too. But we stayed there until August or September of 1941, when the war had broken out between Russia and Germany. first of all mail stopped. From that day on, until then we had been getting mail. We even got a parcel from my mother from Poland, from German-occupied Poland. But the day the war stopped, no mail from the West was arriving anymore. From East, we got some mail later on. And so in August of 41, apparently the Polish exile government in London signed a treaty with the Russians, with the Soviets, which provided for a number of things. The creation of a Polish army in Russia, mm-hmm. with the proviso which was supposed to fight with the Russians. The release of those people who had been at night in June of 1940 sent to Siberia, and other people who had been earlier sent to Siberia who were Polish citizens. But who were Polish citizens, they made a point. There were a couple of people there who claimed they were Czechs and English and other things, and were by coincidence that they wouldn't be released at the time. We allegedly were allowed to go to wherever we wanted. We were supposed to get temporary documents stating that we were Poles, which within a given time had to be exchanged for Polish passports. The problem being that no consulate agreement had been signed and there was no place to really exchange those, turned out later. There were also restrictions.
All right, and you said that there was no organization set up for you to exchange the documents?
There was no organization set up at the point, unless you could get to Kuibyshev, a city on the Volga, where the Polish where the Russian government had been evacuated from Moscow and where the Polish embassy was. But that was difficult to get there. We got into a place called Asbest, A-S-B-E-S-T. It's the center of the Soviet or Russian asbestos industry. It is about 2 hours by train from what the city which was called Sverdlovsk. It's now back Yekaterinburg. That's the place where the last Tsar was murdered by the Soviets. We got into asbest. By misinformation, I thought I'm going to be able to get a job in the ceramics industry, which wasn't so. We worked all kinds of jobs over there, building trades and shoveling snow around the factory, at the end as a mechanics apprentice, setting up punch presses and doing all kinds of things. My father was also working there. And that was really the worst place. And twice from there we were sent to farms in summer, once and one in fall, to help with the harvest, which was good because at least there we had enough to eat. While we were in the city for a long time, we were starving. Until for the first time, help came from the American Poles. There came food supplies and there came clothing. The clothing mostly had come from England. I think the food supplies, a lot of it come from England, but most, some of it from America. There was a big colony of Poles and Jews from Poland there, and luckily the Poles had elected a physician, a doctor, Marek Zuckerman, who was from that Rudnik on the River San, which I had mentioned once, who was the chief distributor of those things. And the reason he was helpful, because there came medication also with it. With some of that medication, he bribed a Soviet minister who was in that town, transferred from Moscow. And the people at the hospital, the minister's wife was sick, and Dr. Zuckerman was called to help her. And so that helped a little bit with the authorities in that town. And so until that help had arrived, we were absolutely miserable. We lived for a long time in dormitories where the only room you had was the room beneath your bed. The sanitary conditions were lousy. Food was scarce. We were swollen from hunger. I had frostbites on both hands. The clothing was torn by then already. So when the stuff came, the Polish help came, it really, we started to live a little bit better. We also had, while we worked on the farm, stolen enough peas, while we were harvesting peas, to support us for a couple of months with some additional food. So that helped. But the Polish army, which had been created under General Anders, soon left the Soviet Union during the Battle of Stalingrad. And besides, they had taken on their limited number of Jews. We found out later on why the Soviets had made that demand. They had not specified Jews. They had specified other minorities than Poles. And they were mainly afraid that people from the territories which they had occupied in 1939 from the Polish parent, that Ukrainians and White Russians would try to join the Polish army in order to get rid of the Soviets. Well, in 1943, the Germans discovered the graves at Katyn, accused the Russians of having murdered thousands of Polish officers. And I won't mention the number, because the numbers we hear are very different. It varies between 5,000 and 10,000. The Soviets said they were murdered by the Germans. The Polish exile government in London demands an explanation, which drives the Soviets mad. And first of all, they close all the temporary consulates, which in the meantime had opened, but were called still only delegations of the embassy. They arrested their heads, and they called all those people like us who had those temporary documents not exchanged into passports to the police and told them, from today on, you are Soviet citizens. And within a short time, we were given some... The explanations they were ridiculous. They said, you were in Tarnopol at the day when there was an election. I said, we were and did not vote on that election. I said, that doesn't mean anything, but you were there when the people of Tarnopol voted to be united with the Soviet Union. So... Now, not only that I was the moment I became a Soviet citizen, against my will, I also became eligible for the draft. As long as I was a Polish citizen, I was not. And so shortly later, about a few weeks later, we are called up to the draft board. I am being given 1A, being a young boy, 22 years old, reasonably healthy, and my father 4F. A few weeks later, I am called to the military office there, and after a lengthy interview with an officer, at which time I was asked if I would serve in the army, I said, if I'm needed, I go, and at which point I had, upon repeated questions, be said what my nationality was. Now, one must understand, to the Russian, nationality does not mean citizenship, but it means really ethnicity. And that ethnicity in Russia is always listed in your identity card. Once a Jew, once a Pole, once a whatever, Chinese, you are, and you and all your heirs are going to be the same. Well, I stated, and we had stated when we had received our temporary Russian documents, that our ethnicity was Polish. Going out from the idea that if the war ends, if we say we are Jewish, religion hasn't been asked. Ethnicity is being asked. If we say that we are Jewish, then when the war ends, we have to stay there, even if there is a Poland. If we say we are Polish, we can go back to Poland. So this way, I got, when I said that I go in the army, and I was told 2 days later to report, I didn't know yet what army I'm going to. It wasn't until 2 days later when I reported at 10 o'clock in the evening to the office that the officer told me where to go, whom to find at the railroad station, and so on. And then it finally he said that if somebody asks you where you are going, tell him you're going to the 1st Polish Kościuszki Infantry Division. And good luck and behave yourself with dignity. And off I went. On June 5th, after all kinds of manipulations being in a collection point and put on a train and traveling, on June 5th, we arrived at a railroad station not far from the town of Ryazan, the city of the railroad station Divovo. There was only one railroad car as a station building. The station had been bombed. Nothing else was there. And we walked about 15 kilometers and crossed a river, Oka, OKA, on a ferry which was pulled by a string by two men over the river, and got into a village called Sielce, S-I-E-L-C-E, where the 1st Division was being created. Everybody had to walk through a narrow entrance, and there was a fellow in uniform standing there, Polish uniform, and he asked everybody for his name. And he obviously, I recognized, was Jewish, and when he saw the name Guttmann, he knew I was Jewish, and he said, you have to write an application that you want to serve in the Polish army or the Polish division as a volunteer, which I did. And I arrived in my unit, was assigned to a unit that same day, and then I arrived in my unit without any papers. And the first thing when they were writing down all our data, I'm asked, what is your ethnicity? And I say, Jewish. Because now I'm in the Polish army, and I don't want to stay there forever. So when the war comes to an end, as a Jew, if they don't kick me out, at least I will be able to get out, which was all right. I stayed with the same unit from June 5th, 1943, till after the end of the war, until we returned into a barracks in Poland. It was the last 8 months of my service. I was transferred to another unit and was in the border guards. I went with that unit from Chelsea on the Oka, first to the area of Smolensk, where we became like a third row of defense. From there we moved to the Ukraine in the area of between two Jewish towns, Zhytomyr and Berdychev, with a little village, Berdykhivka. From there we went to a place in the Ukraine near the city of Lutsk, L-U-C-K, in an area full of anti-Soviet guerrillas, where we had to watch ourselves terribly. We lost, our regiment subsequently lost a truck, which is crew over there. We never recovered neither the crew nor the truck. And from there in beginning of July 1944, we went into action. My regiment was a 120-millimeter mortar regiment. It's an artillery with an artillery shell, weighing 16 pounds, which a reach of 6 kilometers. Fired 38,000 rounds of ammunition during the period when I served with them, and I kept the statistics, so I know what we did. I wrote the history of the regiment after the war for, army, for the mini- Ministry of Defense in Warsaw. And we've participated in the fights from the River Bug to the Vistula, to the right bank of the Vistula in Warsaw, and the left bank of Vistula in January of 1945, to Pomerania, the Baltic Sea at Kolberg, across the Oder River, participated in the surrounding of Berlin, never got into Berlin proper while we were fighting, and to the Elbe River where we were when the war, no, where we were 3 days, and then we were withdrawn to a place near Berlin called Wandlitzsee, where we were when, on May 8th, when the war came to an end.
While you were fighting, did you know what was happening to the Jews of Poland?
Well, first of all, we were fighting against Hitler. We didn't know what happened to the Jews of Poland. Nobody knew at that time. We knew when we came into Poland, we found out no more. But when we joined in Russia, we didn't know what was going on. The last time I heard from my mother was probably through a Red Cross card sometimes in 1941 or 42, where we were in Asbest. That was the last time we heard something from her. By then she was in Sosnovitz in the ghetto. Otherwise, we didn't know. Once we came to Poland, we found out a little bit. The whole colossality of that Holocaust, of that we became a war only after the war, after I was discharged.
So it was only
because in, you see, don't forget, it's 1945. There's no television. Papers are sporadic. Mail is going sporadic. You got an army paper while you're still a soldier. Radio and the army, even so there were military apparatuses. We were not allowed to listen to civilian stations. We didn't always obey. We heard a little bit, especially tried to listen to the BBC, which was, even in later years, much better always than the Voice of America, by the way. And so it took time for all that to find out what it all happened. I had befriended a girl in Warsaw, near Warsaw, with whom I was corresponding. Mail for a soldier is a terribly important thing. She knew that I was Jewish. And she wrote me while I was in Germany that she had found out some Jews survived. And she asked for more information on my mother. And she said she's going to look for her. She didn't find anything. I found that upon my return to Poland by coincidence that there is a Jewish committee in the city of Katowice. And without going into the details, I got there and finally I found out in that committee after, which was not the best organized at the time because people were amateurs. They didn't know how to do things like that. They were trying, everybody, wherever you were during that war, Jews very fast were able to organize committees to help. But they had to learn some of the things. And then I found out that my mother and my sister had survived at a labor camp in the district of Lower Silesia, not far from Breslau, Wrocław. And the camp was known as Peterswaldau, and it was a branch of the notorious Gross-Rosen concentration camp. That was an exclusively women camp. Not far away was a men's camp in Langbilau, which had the nickname Die Sportschule. Mother and sister worked in a metal factory there, a factory which was making bomb mechanisms. Except for the last couple of weeks before the end of the war, they were chased out to dig trenches. But that's where they survived. They subsequently came to America.
Did your father didn't survive the war?
My father died in February of 1944.
What did he die from?
He died of bad combination of pneumonia, undernourishment, and heartache. He was alone. He got sick. He was in the hospital. I had been writing to him. As a matter of fact, I had also, when we came to the Polish army, we were to the Polish division, and we were told that there is in Moscow a committee, which is called the Committee of Polish Patriots, which was instrumental in creating that second time the Polish army. They would help our relatives if they need help. In December of 1943, I was on a special mission as a courier. I passed through Moscow, and I had about 12 hours layover. I went to the committee in my uniform. I reported there where I was. And the lady who opened the door and talked to me when I said my name said, "Oh, yeah, I remember your letter, such a German name." And what she told me was, "Well, we are going to check. We don't have an office in Asbest. We are going to check through our office in some other town. Have to check with the social department in that city if your father needs help. And if the social department informs the city in Kirov that you need it, and Kirov informs us, then we're going to." I mean, you know, it was such a way. I don't know if my father ever got any help. I didn't have any mail from him for months until in June of 1944. I finally got a letter from the first secretary of the party in that factory where my father worked. I had written to the doctor never answered me. I remembered the name of this party secretary because she was a former wife of the Russian foreign minister, Litvinov. Was divorced. She was first secretary of the party in that factory producing military goods. And that's a name you remember. And the name of the factory to give without a street address didn't, in that little town of Asbest, make a problem either. So I wrote a letter to Madame, I called her Tovarish, because now I was in the army, I was a big shot, I could call it Tovarish comrade, Litvinova. And I got a letter from her, and she told me when my father passed away. I was able to obtain a certificate of death from the doctor whom I found 2 days before he left Poland, and he sent it to me. And my mother needed it later when she got, and she remarried here in the United States. Another refugee from Hungary who had lost his wife and 4 children at Auschwitz.
While you were in the army, did you ever come across any of these notorious camps that were scattered through Poland?
The only camp I really passed by was Majdanek. At the time, I wasn't aware what it is. That was the first few weeks when we were in action in July of 1944. We had crossed the Bug River. We had been greeted enthusiastically by the Poles when we came through there. It was a sunny day when the whole convoy stopped because somewhere always a convoy gets into some trouble and something happens. And we stopped just in front of a gate, which I remember, an iron gate which was open. There was a fence surrounding the place, and I saw some construction which turned out to be ovens from which there still was smoke coming out. It was only later that we found out that it was a notorious Camp Majdanek. When you stop on sitting high on a truck and you see something, really don't know yet what it is until somebody later tells you what it was. So that was the camp there. We came to another, not this kind of camp, an encampment where the Germans had been training foreign police, which Lithuanian, Estonian, Polish, from all those occupied countries where they needed policemen. We came in that camp that was near the city town of Puławy, P-U-L-A-W-Y, on the Vistula, in a little village there, outside in the forest. There were some of the barracks had been destroyed. There were still peeled potatoes in the kitchen and the big, huge vats where they were supposed to be cooked. And I found a volume of interesting documents from one policeman who apparently had joined there and was reluctant and escaped. And there was such a volume of paperwork with him escaping and being caught and escaping and being caught. And that was the first time we also realized that the Germans had been training foreign policemen in the war. Other camps I did not come by until after the war. I passed by quite often at Auschwitz because there was an important railroad going there, which I took to go to some villages in the mountains during vacation time. So, but otherwise, I did not come. We were not too far from Stutthof, apparently. And as I, at one point, the first Jews after the war who had survived were a group of Jewish youngsters. I mean youngsters, they were in the late teens, beginning 20s probably, who had survived, I believe it was Stutthof. I met later on quite a few of them in Katowice and Sosnowitz, Beuthen and Sosnowitz. They were in kibbutzim, kind of, preparing to go to Israel, and I spent the high holidays in 1945 and at a kibbutz after a lot of haggling with my military commander who wouldn't give me off today.
You said that when you were the train before you went to Siberia, they took off all the bachelors and you never found out what happened to them till 1943. What happened to them?
They were taken, first of all, in Tarnopol to the jail. And it was a terrible, that was like an old fortress. From there, they were taken on trains, which the kind which Solzhenitsyn describes in his Gulag Archipelag, where each fellow sits in a little separate cell so that he can communicate with the others. In wagons like this, they were taken, and they were taken to camps, which in Siberia, we were not surrounded by a fence. There was a forest, and we went to work without a guard. Well, he got into a real gulag-type camp where the people went to work with guards in quarries, stone quarries, among others. That particular fellow who had been the chief of that restaurant chain for which I worked in Tarnopol for a while, he had military boots, high boots, new ones in the military belt. He exchanged that with the commander of the jail for being assigned to the kitchen. And that what saved him. Many of them didn't survive there. There was tough work. There was a lot of infighting going on because the guards were stealing in some of the, similar like in the concentration camps. Some of the foremen or kind of capos, they didn't call them in Russia that, were involved in trades and stealing and some of oppression of some of the other guys. They had worked in job assignments and so on. And some of the people really suffered, and a lot of people died in those camps.
Good decision that you and your father didn't go.
Good decision that we didn't go. Good decision that we didn't. They did wanted them to separate because they knew families will have a hard time to escape. And if you're a single person, you're taking a risk much easier. I won't take a risk and leave my father alone there. And to go together with my father, who was, from my point of view, as a 19-year-old, an elderly fellow, okay, I wouldn't have dared to take him because he wouldn't be able. So that was the reasoning while they separated those so-called bachelors.
What date were you discharged from the Army?
I was discharged from the Army March of 1945. It was, I think, on the papers it was the 12th, and in reality it was about the 15th of March or 14th of March, something like that, from a unit in the Border Guards in a resort in the mountains in Lower Silesia, where for the last few months I had a rather pleasant service. I had been in a job which had been really was designed for a commissioned officer, and I was about 2 months away from getting a commission. They had a rule at the time, if somebody served 6 months in a job assigned for a commissioned officer, he could pass an examination. I wasn't eager. I wanted to get out.
Do you know that's 51 years ago this time of the year?
It was 1946.
Was it 1946?
It wasn't 1946.
So it's 50 years ago.
50 years ago.
As we sit here today on March 14th, 1996.
Yes, about 50 years ago. I'm sorry, it's 45. The war just, on 9th of May, the war ended. It was 46, I misspoke. And that's when I got out. And I was mighty glad. I had the offer from somebody, one of the officers, says, would you like to join the secret police? And I said,
Okay. All right. You are discharged from the Army and you find your mother and sister. We know that you remained in Poland at this time?
I remained in Poland at this time.
You eventually married?
I got married in August of 1946.
And her name is?
Ingeborg Erika, a maiden name Bart, B-A-R-T-H.
And you lived in Poland?
I lived in Poland in various places. First in the place where I met my mother. Then I moved in the same county in a town. And then subsequently I moved back to Upper Silesia because we had problems with my son and I was working and so on.
Right.
We needed to go somewhere where somebody could take care of my son. And so Upper Silesia was a better place.
We need to introduce your son. Whose name is?
My son is George Andrei. He was born in 1947.
Where at?
In that same village where my mother was in a concentration camp, where I married my wife, which was at that time called Peterswalda or Piotrolesie Pieszyce, when he was born. P-I-E-S-Z-Y-C-E. And he lives now in Rocky River. Has a master's degree in political science. His wife has a PhD in clinical psychology. They have two wonderful children.
And what are their names?
Andrei Markus, after me and my great grandfather, and Genevieve Camille. Andrei is 7, and Genevieve is, we call it Viva, is 5. He's in first grade and she's in kindergarten. My son works for a company here in Closure as a sales manager. My daughter-in-law is in private practice a little bit and she works for the Veterans Administration.
You and your wife and your son tried to get out of Poland several times?
The first time I tried to get on it for a visit to my mother's cousin in Sweden wanted to meet my mother in Sweden when things eased up in Poland after 1956, because in 1956 there was a big turnover in Poland and things eased up a little. My mother wouldn't come to Poland. He had a cousin in Sweden. The Poles denied me the passport. The second time we applied for a passport to go to Israel, because my mother had applied for a visa first to come to America. But at the time, the American immigration law was such that I would have to come alone as the son of a already naturalized American citizen. My wife and my son would have to stay back in Poland until I got here. And I was afraid to leave him there. The only way out for all of us was to go to Israel. I wasn't afraid to live in Israel. I know she could get out from there at any time. But while we were in Israel, we got out of Poland finally in 1959. After I wrote to everybody, after they had denied my passport the second time, I wrote to everybody, including the president of the country. I did not give up. When I'm determined to do something, I get it done. And so we got out, we got to Israel, and we stayed 13 months in Israel, where we both worked. My wife was a housekeeper, and myself in a toy factory assembling tricycles. And there I started earnestly to learn English, to study English. Came to America in 1960.
When in 1960?
April 22nd, 1960, aboard the good ship Olympia, probably owned by Onassis. I think that was one of the Greek line he owned, that whole thing, which we didn't know at the time. It was meaningless to us. The voyage took about 2 weeks. We had been staying for 3 days in Athens, where the day before, the first time we stepped on the American continent was the day before in Halifax, Nova Scotia. It was bitter cold. We arrived in New York April 22nd, 84 degrees in our winter clothes.
In April 22nd, 84 degrees isn't bad.
Yeah. It was hot.
What has been your occupation since arriving in the United States?
Well, mainly that what I did in Europe. I worked since I came out of the Army, in accountant-related jobs, payroll, cost accounting, sometimes both, sometimes only one of them. When I came to Cleveland the first 3 months, I worked in a shop assembling lamps and so for a company called Funeral Supply Company. Then I worked for 8 years for a wholesaler, gasoline, and did everything, accounts payable, accounts receivable, tax reports on excise taxes, and so on. And then for the last 18 years, I was in charge of cost accounting and payroll at a manufacturer of molded rubber products for the automobile aftermarket. I had to leave there in the end of 1986 when the company went belly up. I still worked for them 2 years part-time when they had a reduced staff of 10 people. And since then, I have been working temporarily, sometimes for a week or two in assorted accounting jobs, just 3 months for BP America and Department of Excise Taxes. And I started to write. I had gotten a third prize in a story writing contest in Germany with an institution. I have published about a little bit more than a dozen articles in a German paper, and I have published 2 parts of my memoirs on my childhood in Boyd in Katowice. The one is now being reprinted in Poland and is in bilingual in German and Polish simultaneously with a Polish translation, which I made after I got one, which was unsatisfactory to me.
Be fair to say your grandkids are the light of your life?
My grandkids, I tried to tell him some stuff. We have a problem. My daughter-in-law is American-born. And as such, like many Americans, does not very fond of foreign languages. We wanted to to teach our grandchildren when they were little, and she was afraid that she might not understand them, and we talked of German to them. I don't know. And when they, if we started off, my grandson had a very good ear, and he can know a few phrases, and he can use a few Polish phrases, and use some Polish songs a little bit. And I'm sorry that they don't want to learn. And I'm not getting much support from either one of them. So what can I do? Shrug my shoulders. I'm preparing the albums with photos which I have of my family with inscriptions little so that they know who some of the people are, going back to my great-grandfather, my maternal grandparents, paternal grandparents, from my youth, from my mother's, from my wife's youth, whatever I can. Where I find it proper, I put in some of the indications of who the people are. I also am collecting what I can of my father's writings. And I have two larger articles in the book which we edited. So that if they want to know, then there is going to be a trace. If they don't want to know, I'm going to send the stuff probably to the Leo Beck Institute in New York. I spoke to a man over there a week ago. I still am going to try to find my father's doctoral dissertation. I know where it was done and when it was done, but it was never, as it's customary in Germany, printed, because in 1919 there was no paper to print it on.
Can you tell us what the Holocaust has meant to you in your life?
Well, first of all, it meant that I lost a lot of my family and I lost almost all my friends. This is where it hits the closest. I mean, it hits you if you know that 1 million people are being killed, or 2 million or 3 million. By at a certain point, it doesn't make any difference anymore if it's 1 million or 2 million or 3 million. I mean, 1 million people. This is a lot of people. But if it hits close to home, I think we're going to show the list of the Gestapo, the city of Beuthen, where there's a date when my grandmother was taken away and sent out, and two or three of her brothers are in that list. And assorted uncles and friends and parents of friends. This is where it hits home. And if I came back in 1945 to the city where I was born as a soldier, we drove through on a truck. We had a garrison 20 miles out of there. And you come, and the next day I was in the city going to the Jewish committee. And you come to the city where you were born, and there is not, the city is very little destroyed. Few houses here and there. By and large, it is whole. Because there's industries that they don't want to destroy. But there's not a single soul in that city whom you know. You are a stranger. This is something for Americans can't comprehend. That an American soldier goes to war, and he comes back, and there is nobody there in South Euclid, in Mayfield Heights, and wherever it is, in East Cleveland. All your friends, you find some of them, this one is in Israel, and one is maybe in Australia, and one is somewhere else. Some of the distances, you're never going to see them again. You find little by little people. My mother wrote to the radio station in Warsaw, a name, at the Red Cross was published names. And my aunt is standing in Haifa on a street corner and having her shoes polished, what she seldom did, and hears that my mother is alive since they are announcing it. I am having a good memory, and I remember that my aunt lived in Haifa Ahuza on Telmanei 2. The short address. Telmanei means Manei Hill. And as a soldier, and I remember that as soon as I got into Poland and the mail is going, I write a letter to Paul Freund, Haifa Husa, Telman A2. They know that I'm alive. The girl I fell in love with in Tarnopol, who came three times to me to the train, I have rumors. People have seen that. Where she died, when she died, but nothing for sure. Your friends, I was a member of the Zionist organization in Katowice from about 1934 to 1939. There is one guy in California who was the head of the organization in that town for a while. I have tried with him to make contact. I couldn't.
Can you tell me, is there anything you'd like to say to future generations about this period?
Never again. Sorry. Sure. I think I'm grateful to Steven Spielberg. For making that possible. I have been seldom so moved as I was after watching Schindler's List. Not because of Schindler, because of the people he showed, Warschau, the camps. Schindler was an aberration, coincidence. I don't know if he was good or if he was greedy. It doesn't matter. I had at one time a discussion with a man who said, I should be grateful to the Soviets because he saved my life. And I said, no. And I'm not such a Jewish scholar that I knew that at the time, but I know it now. Because there's a Jewish law which says the intent is important of a deed. The Russian intent was not to save my life. If the Russian intent had been to save my life, it would have been what is called in Hebrew a mitzvah, a good deed. What they did was not a good deed. It turned out to be against their intentions, because I told you, they told us, you're going to die here in Siberia. They didn't want to save us. So Schindler remains in a way an enigma. Did he do it because he wanted to save? If that was the reason, then he did a good deed. If otherwise, it was a coincidence. And even so, and as a friend of my father's used to say, the result is of an action is important, which is a little bit contradictory with a Jewish interpretation. So it's all right. He saved people. But for Spielberg, first of all, to make the movie, and how he made it, and for Mr. Williams to write the music, for Itzhak Perlman to play it. And that Steven Spielberg now takes the money to make this project. This is a good deed.
Thank you for sitting here to do this project with us.
I'm glad I could be able to do it.
I'm glad you came.
This is my great grandfather, my maternal great grandfather, Adolf Becker, in Boyton. Oh, that's probably in the late 1920s, beginning 1930s. He died in 1937 at the age of 92.
So it was taken in Boyton?
In Boyton.
How was it that you have this picture?
I think it came to my mother from one of her cousins, who immigrated from Boyton to Palestine in 1933. At that time, they had a lot of money. They went as capitalists, and they could take everything with them. And so since they had a lot of stuff, she gave some of it to my mother.
And who is this a picture of?
These are my maternal grandparents, Eugen and Flora Wachsner. That is a wedding picture taken in Boyton, Oberschlesien, Bittum Upper Silesia, in 1899.
And do you have this picture like you have the other one?
This is probably also came from my aunt in Israel. I am not 100% sure because many of those pictures I had from my mother when my mother passed away here in Cleveland. And some of them, of course, I don't know how she was able to get them.
Okay, thank you. Who is this a picture of?
These are my paternal grandparents, Bernhard Guttmann and Olga Guttmann-Nay-Sachs. That picture was taken already in Berlin when they were old, probably in her short, probably not too long before they were deported to Theresienstadt, probably around 1940. Again, it came from my mother's collection somewhere, possibly from my father's sister, possibly from my father's sister who lived in Australia.
Thank you. And who's this picture?
This is my father, Dr. Fritz Guttmann, with my mother, Gertrud Guttmann, Ney Wachsner. That is taken probably shortly after they got married, we got married in 1920. My father is very skinny over there, and the years when I remember him, he was rather heavy. So that is probably then. That came in all probability from my aunt from Australia.
Okay. And who is this a picture of?
That is my sister Vera Pauline. She's about 6 months old there. That must have been in 1931. She's born in 1931. She was born in Boyton, now Bittum. That is still in our. No, that was done at a professional photographer studio.
That's fine. All right, what's the picture of?
This is a list, one page of a list from the Boyton Oberschlesien Gestapo, from the deportation of the last 940 about, I think that's the last number there, 950 Jews from that city, which took place between May 14, 1942 and beginning of June. On that page, underlined with highlighter, is my grandmother, my maternal grandmother.
And how was it that you kept this?
I have that list through a girl who was from Boyton, who is in a kibbutz in Israel, who made a visit to Boyton in the late 70s, late 80s. How she obtained it in Boyton, I don't know, but I was sent a copy of it from Israel, from the kibbutz Lehavot HaBashan. This is Max Rum Guttmann, Sergeant Major in Polish Army, in the place of Duszniki in mountains near Graz in spring of 1946. Either fall of 45 or spring of 46. It's a synagogue in Beuthen, Oberschlesien, and where I was singing as a boy in the choir. Adjacent, in one of the two houses adjacent to it, that was the place, was called Schießhausplatz. In one of those buildings, my mother was born.
And this picture is taken from the book cover that was just shown in the series.
Yeah, the book was published in 1992. Under the auspices of a foundation called House Oberschlesien.
Thank you. What is this picture?
This is a picture of a. of a kind of a substitute for a birth document. People used to get books for their families where they could record the parents' weddings, birth of their children. This is what is called in German ein Stammbuch. And there is in the front, the first page is a marriage certificate of my parents, and the second page the birth certificates of my sister and myself. Do you want to both of them or you are going to page?
Just the 105.
Okay.
How do you have this document?
This is my mother schlepped it through the camps. How she was hiding it, I don't know. She must have had a way of hiding it, but she schlepped it through the camps.
Max, who is this a picture of?
This is the picture of my grandchildren, Andre and Viva.
And when was this picture taken?
That picture was taken probably, how old are they? Probably
he was about
five and four.
2 years maybe.
Five and three.
And this was taken in Cleveland?
That was taken in Rocky River.
Thank you. What is this a picture of?
This is a picture of, I think, George and his wife and my wife and myself and my little granddaughter. And Andre, his grandson, took the picture. That is in their new home in which they moved in December of 1993 in Rocky River.
Your daughter-in-law's name is?
My daughter-in-law's name is Deborah.
And your wife's name is?
My wife's name is Ingeborg.
And your granddaughter's name?
My granddaughter's name is Viva, we call her.
Thank you very much.
Jennifer.